What's up, everybody? It's Jeremy, and this is Jeremy's World 10. We are back in the studio here up in what we call the attic, which is hidden away at our fun facility here at Weld Tech Designs. And today I have a guest on there you probably never even heard of. This guy just, you know, came out of a hole somewhere, and we're going to have some fun talking and BSing. And I think what I'm looking forward to most about this whole conversation is I feel like every time we get on a phone call, we're like two little kids just giggly, having fun, joking around about, you know, our dreams, our passions, what we love doing. And it just happens to be that we both love Vans. Today's guest is the one, the only, the man, the myth, the legend, Chrome.
What's up, you guys, man? How you doing? It's awesome to be here.
Dude, so nice to do this. I know we've talked about it for a while. I keep saying I'm going to get back up here and talk to more people because I love hearing people's stories. I mean, it's so awesome to see where people are at now, but like where they've come from, I think is equally important because so often today people are so like hyper focused on, oh, like success and all of, you know, what they see on YouTube, on social media, that they forget about all the hard work that it took to get there. Some by accident and some, you know, just complete dedication to their life, to their craft, getting better. And I think that that is what is going to be fun about today's conversation with you, because there's so much more to you than, you know, people would think. And even, you know, I'm learning new things about you today. So I want to go back to, we're going to like jump in this time machine and we're going back like to the beginning about your story. And I mean, first of all, let's talk about where were you born? Where did you grow up?
I was born and raised in the Fraser Valley, just outside of Vancouver, BC.
Okay.
Yeah.
And till what age did you live there? How long was that?
I stayed in the Valley. Well, pretty much in the Valley a majority of my life. I think we moved out of the Valley. I was probably 18, 19 by the time I moved out of the Valley. And then we started moving closer to the city.
Like you as in your family, or you left your family? Like,
yeah. Yeah, I left my family. So I was born and raised in a small town called Abbotsford. And we were around there till I was probably about 14. And then we had moved around a little bit from place to place. And then when I turned 18, I moved out of home. And then from there, I moved out closer towards the city because it was closer to more DJ work at the time. I was a DJ from a very, very young age.
Oh, yeah. We're going to get into that here. You know, talk about some slinging singles and having some fun.
Lots
of
it.
You know, yeah. So, I mean, that is awesome. So when you turned 18, was it kind of you just wanted to get out of your house sort of thing and do your own, you know, hey, I'm, you know, was it an independence? I can do this. I don't need you. Like, where were you at? Like, do you feel like your mindset was at during that time?
Yeah. I mean, like, I was like, at the time I got into a lot of partying at the time. So for me, you know, being around home and stuff, when you're 18, it's time to go. So, yeah, we just ended up moving out and I was DJing full time at the time. Like I've been a DJ since I was 14. And then once I started to turn 19, I was in the clubs full time. So yeah, we were quite partying a lot around that time.
So then obviously that was that something that created conflict, like with your, in your home life with your parents, or is that?
No, I've always like been pretty independent at home. It was just me and my mom. So, you know, so like I was always super independent. Like as a kid, I spent a lot of time by myself in my bedroom with my headphones on, playing with my DJ music. I was always like a solitude, independent kid that just did his own creative thing, you know? So, and that's just unfolded through like being a kid and dreaming about being a radio host guy back in the day. And then that turned into me DJing at a roller rink when I was young. I started DJing at a roller rink when I was 14. And then when I turned 19, I hit the clubs. But yeah, I've always been like a solitude, quiet kid at home.
So is that what you felt like was like such a good escape and release, was just being able to like really get in tune with the music and kind of just be one, you know, essentially with it? I mean, what was the draw to music?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure what the draw to music was. There was never a DJ or anything like that in my family. My dad played guitar, but I didn't know him very well. But
okay,
yeah, just I think when I was a kid, I was like the fat little kid in high school that nobody ever liked. Nobody talked to me. I got bullied and beat up. And for some reason, I just gravitated to putting my headphones on and DJing. And then when I was 14, still had no friends, I was DJing at the local roller rink every Thursday, Friday, Saturday night. And the booth was so high up, nobody knew it was me. And they were just having the time of their lives. It was, I don't know, like a secret way for me to express who I was without, you know, being in front of everybody's face when I was younger. And I just got good at it.
Then were you into roller skating as well, or just the DJ part?
It was just the DJ just part. The DJ. Yeah, okay. Just the DJ. Like that was back when I was playing those. You remember those cassette singles with cardboard around it? You push the cassette out.
Okay.
You remember those?
No.
No. You oh my gosh.
Push the cassette out.
Yeah, it was just.
No, I mean,
it was just a cassette single, so it was only like one or had like kind of like a. Yeah, it was a cassette single, so it had one regular version of the track and a couple remixes on it. That was it.
Oh, no, so I remember that on, like, a normal cassette tape because that was, like, I remember going back to being like, oh, I love this song, and, like, hitting record on the stereo because it was, like, I wanted this one song on my, like, you know, my hit tape list, you yeah, know, yeah. that I could put in my giant jukebox when I wanted to go break dance.
We are,
you
know, old.
You know, so yeah, no, that was it. So yeah. That was the only option. I couldn't go download my favorite song.
Oh yeah, right? That's crazy nowadays.
And I remember just loving when CDs came out because there was always that one song you loved and you could just fast forward to that song. You didn't have to like fast forward. Okay, stop. Fast forward, stop. Fast forward, stop. Oh, I missed it. I went too far. I got to rewind it a little bit, you know? So oh, I think that was...
Your kids will never know the struggle.
Oh, they won't, you know? Like, oh, hold on. Let me go change the... Let me go flip the tape over. I mean, yeah. I remember when tape players in cars would automatically flip it over. And to me, I was like... So then when you were DJing, was it... mostly records? Were you doing tapes or what?
Yeah,
how would you do that?
Yeah, I started with cassette singles when I was 14. And then as I got a little older, CDs started coming out. So I transitioned into CDs. And then when I got into the clubs when I was 19, we just did all vinyl. That's all we did was all vinyl for the whole time. And then vinyl turned into MP3s. And then they had this DJ software that came out, allowed us to kind of throw all our music in one thing. But then I still continued to spin vinyl. So I ended up using the control vinyl turntable. So you just throw a vinyl record on the turntable, drop the needle on it like you would a regular record, but it had a beeping sound on it. Then that was linked back through a junction box, which connected to your computer, which allowed me to play MP3s on my turntables. So for my whole club career, I continued to spin vinyl the whole time, except for MP3s for the last part of it.
All right, so now you are going to go on and you are going to put on your favorite mix. Like, what kind, like, what is the genre of music that you're like, okay, we're getting these people pumped for this? Like, what are we doing?
Well, if you're talking about my personal, I'm a huge electronic dance music fan. That's me through and through. But as my DJ stuff, I mean, I was a multi-genre DJ. So as long as it was top 40 and in the club, I would play it. So, like... because of that, I played out sometimes 5-6 nights a week for a majority of my club career. Like, I was full-time in it. And I gave my DJ career the same dedication I give my YouTube channel. Like, just go, go, go. Like, all in, pedal to the floor, 100% let's go. So that's why I got to work so much, is because if someone wanted a hip-hop night on a Wednesday, I'm like, let's go, I'm in. Someone wanted to do like an all dance Fridays, let's go. Or they wanted to do an all 90s whatever day, I was like, yeah, let's go. I said yes to everything as long as it was in the club scene. Like, I wouldn't play no pubs or anything like that. I was like straight nightclubs.
You want people like dancing, having a good time. Like, So then what was, if that seems like something that you were so passionate about, tell me what led you into Fraser Valley Reptiles?
Oh my God. I can't believe you found that. That's hilarious.
So, so how did we go from in the club pumping it up to playing with geckos, bearded dragons, and chameleons?
My gosh, you guys had your investigation team dig deep. I always, because I just because I got DJ'd full time, all my stuff was all at night. Okay. So I bought a bearded dragon once and it was just giant. And I called him Dre, as in from Dr. Dre. I called him Dre because he was just gangster. He was big. And, you know, after I got him, and then I got a female one once, and then they mated and had these little buggers, and then I just, that was it. Like, because I had nothing to do during the day. So during the day, I was like, you know, all my friends were getting into producing beats and stuff like that, and I was never good at doing that stuff. So during the day, I'm like, I need something to pass my time. So yeah, I bred one to another, and they had babies, and then I went and sold them, and I'm like, okay, cool. And that kind of unfolded and kept unfolding. And then before you know it, I ended up starting a company. We started supplying pet stores. We go to pet expos and stuff like that. That's insane you found that.
So yeah, I mean, that's what, I mean, I think it's funny because now my daughter is, so she is 8 years old, Kendall, amazing, is just complete opposite of my son. And so she has caught some alligator lizards right now and has been taking care of them and having fun with them and catching crickets for them. And now she is all about a bearded dragon. So
yeah, they're cool, man.
You know, so that's probably in my very near future is getting one of these. So I definitely think that that is funny. So now how long did you do this for?
Oh, years, probably 5 years maybe or so. And I've always been the guy just to go all in on something that I'm feeling right there in the moment. Then when that's done, I just move on. But like I got in, when I got into it, like I was living in a guy's basement suite at the time. He was a good buddy of mine. And I had this beautiful rack system along that whole wall downstairs. It was probably, I don't know, 20 feet long. And it was just all custom built tanks on top of each other. We had bearded dragons, leopard geckos, and chameleons.
Okay.
Yeah, we all got into chameleons for that little while. I bought a pregnant set from a girl, and she just didn't want to wait because there's a long time for like while they're pregnant before they actually lay the eggs, and so she didn't have the patience. So I bought them. Man, those little buggers are this big, and they're so freaking cute.
Really?
Yeah. So yeah, I got into that for a while, and then I had some people that were buying them from me on a regular basis that ended up asking if I'd ever be interested in selling, that they were looking at getting into the business. So I'm like, okay, cool. So I ended up just selling everything I had when I got done with it to customers I might at the time.
But all meanwhile, still doing spinning records at night.
Yeah, still spinning records at night.
So then after we got rid of Fraser Valley Reptiles, is that when sports cards started or what did we do in here?
My gosh. Okay, so that's... Holy crap. So when I was young, like I've always been an entrepreneur type, always, right?
Okay.
So when I was younger, I was DJing at the roller rink. And then around about the time when I was 16, I actually started a mobile DJ service. I don't know if you got that on your list, but I started.
I don't have that part.
So I started a mobile DJ service and just trying to like get into some other stuff because I, you know, DJing at the roller rink was paying a little bit, but not paying a lot. So doing like a wedding or stuff like that was paying a whole lot more. So I was like, well, let's get into doing this. And during that time, I was still DJing at the roller rink a few nights a week. I take a few Saturdays off to do a few weddings. And the name of that company was Rhythmic Sensations Mobile Music. Horrible name.
Could you imagine doing that.com?
Yeah, right.
You know, like, and nobody would ever find that landing page. They're I don't even know what you just said.
Yeah, so the
send
funny,
me a link.
The funny part about that is I ran that company for a year, then we changed it to West Coast DJs. Because you could never remember, like some guy came up to me once and he's like, hey, you're the DJ at that company. I couldn't remember the name. Is it Pelvic Sensations Mobile Music?
Oh,
I'm like,
yeah.
No. So right then, because like a bunch of people said it was hard to remember. So I changed it to West Coast DJs and we ran that for a while. And I ended up selling that company for like $3,000. It was nothing. So there's another DJ company. Like when I was done with it, he just wanted my client base. He's like, I'll give you $3,000 for it. And I was back, I was young. I'm like, okay, I'll take $3,000.
Right.
And then I just got rid of doing that. But it was around that time I was probably, I was younger. That was before the DJ stuff. I was 14.
Okay.
I think it was 14 when I did the sports card thing. Sorry, I thought it was after 16, but I think it was 14. I was really into sports cards and I had this bright idea. My uncle's like, I'll fund it. What do you want to do? I'm like, I want to sell sports cards at the flea market. I want a table. And my uncle just gave me money. We went and bought a bunch of stuff and I threw...
What year do you think this is?
I don't remember. I was 50. So I'm turning 50 this year. So I'm guessing...
Hey, you and me both. When's your birthday?
Nice. August 16th.
All right. So you got me beat. I'm October, so... Yep, this is a big 5-0. We just have to throw a big party, big rager this year.
Yeah, I'm excited for this year. I'll be on the road somewhere. But so yeah, I'm not sure. I think I was probably 15, maybe.
When so this is like circa 1986.
Yeah.
You know, because that's when I was huge into baseball cards.
Yeah.
I mean, that was my thing too. I got into it in 1984 and just had fun. I was big into baseball, playing baseball. You know, we'd go to these shows where I'd be buying cards from other guys like you, trying out there, hustle them.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was definitely fun. So you moved on from then that. Now, where is it? Football, baseball, like hockey? Like what kind of cards, or just any kind of cards?
Just any kind of cards. We just got into selling everything. And funny thing is, I wasn't even a sports fan. I had no interest in sports at all whatsoever. My uncle was into sports and got me into like hockey cards and stuff like that. And I didn't know the teams. I was just weird. It's that entrepreneur mind was like, I want to sell those things at the flea market. And my uncle put in on it and we got out to the flea market. We started to sell sports cards and I turned my one table into two tables. And I think probably by the time, like we did that for probably about 3 years on, it was just on Sundays at the flea market.
Okay.
Probably did that for 3 years. And by the time I was done, I was four tables deep. It's just me by myself. Sometimes my mom would come by. I had four tables long and I even had some of the local sports card shops, right? They're like from in town would come down to me and say, how are you selling these cards so cheap? Because like I was buying packs. I'd go to the big sports card expo things and I wheel and deal with these guys. And my uncle was like, you are vicious, dude. I get the price down. I'd buy it, go to the flea market and I'd sell it cheaper than the sports card companies in town. And I was just a kid.
Dude, that's awesome. But that's what's crazy is like, you can see that like entrepreneurial spirit started such at an early age, no matter what it is. And I think that that's one of the biggest encouraging things to take away from this is it doesn't matter. Some people think, I'm too young or I'm too old or, you know, whatever that is. And that is just a reason that you are giving yourself for not succeeding.
That's right.
And I think it doesn't matter what age you are. It's like, hey, start something new. I'm always encouraging, you know, my own kids that they're never too young to start a business, to find something that you're passionate about, that you like. And it may not be your forever, but at least each one of these things are giving you the building blocks to set you up for future success in whatever you do, whether it be, you know, who knows, like how. Now, you said that I want to circle back on this. So you liked talking to people because you're always doing these businesses where they're out talking to people, but just at school, it was more introverted.
Huge. Like I didn't talk to nobody liked me in school. I was just a fat kid, like a big kid, and nobody liked me. I had no friends. I had one friend. I think we kind of like stopped being friends when I left school. But yeah, we were just one. It was just one nerdy guy. All I remember about that kid was he's into dinosaurs. We used to ride bikes together. But he was now, the same way as me. Just like an outsider that nobody wanted to be around.
Now is it that? Maybe, and I'm just, you know, going off crazy here just as, and I'll get back on topic, but like, because once you get to know you, it seems like you made friends in everything you did, you know? So it was like, once they get to know you, they were like, hey, this dude's cool. We want to come talk to him. We want to do this, but just at school, it just was the opposite, huh?
It was 100% the opposite. Like I absolutely had the worst time in the world through elementary school and high school. I don't know why, but yeah, I had seriously, it was rough. I didn't like school whatsoever, but it was weird because once I got out, like I said, like the DJ side, when I was a kid, I felt like that was my only way to express myself was the music side. Like it made me feel like I was letting something inside of me out. And then, yeah, I just think as years went forward, you know, and once I got into the public eye, I changed a lot though. You know what I mean? Like from going from like 16 forward, I had changed a little bit. I had lost some weight, gained some confidence and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, then it was different. Once I turned 19, it was go time. Like I was public face everywhere, club posters everywhere. You know, like I was no shy guy whatsoever.
So what do you think was that thing that changed you? Or if there was a young kid watching this, and they said, hey, this is the one thing that helped me and maybe it could essentially help you. What would you, that bit of advice that you would give to that? So there's, I don't know if you ever heard Alex Hormozi. He talks about the Solomon principle, where he talks to his younger self, right? Yeah. So if you were to go back and talk to your younger self at the age of 16, what is the one piece of advice that you would give him to potentially help him to be farther along or get over the obstacles that he faced at that time?
Yeah.
Going deep here.
Yeah. See, like, I think what happened at the time is I listened to everybody. What they said, I felt. You know what I mean? Okay. When they said something to me, I felt like it was true. And then I started to believe that way. So instead of realizing that those people are just like, they're going through tough times. If someone wants to sit there and rip you down, their life's probably not good on the other end. So to me back then, when someone was calling me names or pushing me down or whatever they were doing, I kind of always like felt like I deserved it and I didn't deserve it. Right. So like, and for me, focusing on the one thing that I did have control of, which was my music, it just, I went all in on the one thing I felt passionate about. So if I were to look back at my younger self, it would be, don't listen to everybody, express myself however I feel like I want to express myself, and stand up to those who wanted to push me down. Because when I finally did, they didn't do nothing. I'm like, I was scared of those people. And then when I finally did stand up and go, yeah, what? They were like, yeah, that was it. They backed down. So if my younger self just realized that those people on the other end of that nasty, harsh words are doing worse than I was on the other end of those, you know.
And you see that a ton, I think, on the internet, because now it's so easy for people to just say stuff because there's nothing there. Like, you know, it's, you know, keyboard warriors and all those things. It's like, I always joke about Wreck-It Ralph, but there's a kids movie and he says, don't read the comments, you know, because if you do, I mean, it's like, I just could never imagine taking the time to do that. I mean, I know that I was bullied a bunch in school, but there was no bullying back then. It was what it was, you know. Yeah. You had the popular kids that would pick on, you know, and I was a little guy in school. So, I mean, I totally get it and understand, you know, I felt like it wasn't until high school that I was finally able to just like, hey, I don't care. I'm having fun, you know, and just gonna do me. But I could definitely see that. So my next question is on here is, do you miss the Yellow Pages? So I almost have to have MV. So elaborate on the Yellow Pages.
So when I started my mobile DJ service, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yellow Pages. Yeah. When I started my mobile DJ service, I was 16. I remember that. I was 16. I went to the, Yellow Pages used to have a big, huge building.
Giant book.
Yeah. And I went to the big building down there and I'm a 16-year-old kid and I walked in there and I'm like, I want to take out an ad in the Yellow Pages. They're like, you? I'm like, yes, me. So I sat down, took a bunch of money that I had saved away, and Yellow Pages was not freaking cheap at the time. Like, to buy an ad was crazy. So right. I bought an ad that was probably about that big. Like, it was
inch and an eighth by inch and an eighth.
Yeah. Yeah. It wasn't small. And I went to the Yellow Pages and I took out my own ad. That was for I did twice. I did one for Rhythmic Sensations Mobile Music and another one.
That name took up the whole ad.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah.
And then I
just putting that on there.
Yeah, and then after that I upgraded the ad to West Coast DJs. But yeah, I was a young kid, just super young, you know.
Dude, I love it.
Ambitious and pushing forward,
and still that. I mean, that is so awesome.
So,
yeah,
so you guys know, if you guys hear any weird audio, my dog's been chewing at my foot trying to get my attention this whole time.
Dude, hey, tell him, you know, he can have his time. We get up on there and say hi to, you know. So you left the small town that you were in, you moved, you know, more to a dense population because you were saying like, that's where the clubs were. That's where that was. Do you find, because I look at where you're at now, which is such an opposite of the, you know, dense population, lots of people, like you're completely 180 of that now.
Yeah.
And now do you feel like you just, you're more in your element, or do you sometimes miss that and want to be like, hey, let's go spin some records?
Yeah, I sometimes miss it. I actually have I keep my DJ gear beside me, so anytime I want to play around.
Oh, there we go. Look
I'm
at
like
that.
Locked and loaded right here.
Yay.
Right? So, I mean, like, obviously I don't bring the, I have a turntable set up at my shop, but in the van, I just use that. But yeah, I do get the urge, and I do miss the club scene a lot sometimes. There's sometimes more than others. But it's weird because if I look back at the beginning times of my YouTube channel, I was all about public and I was all about, you know, being in the city and stuff like that. And to look at myself now, 6 and some years later, I just rather stay way the heck away from people. Like right now, we're about 30 kilometers out into the backcountry doing this via Starlink.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, so we went from the DJ. Now I know we're going to get to like where we're at now. So what was the next big, you know, life element that you would say? I know that you have a daughter and she is how old now?
She turns 18 this year.
Okay. So married, that was a big part of your life. How long were you married for?
You really want to tell that story?
Yeah.
So I met this great girl. So like over my club career, meeting girls were, well,
you meet really them. Difficult.
Yeah. You meet them all the time, but they were also just like one time, two time, you know what I mean? Or you see them at the club and the club only. We're not going to get into that
here.
But, and then, anytime you did meet somebody, they were always jealous. You know what I mean? They're jealous of the club, jealous of the girls. So I finally meet this girl. She was a waitress at a bar. And she was only a waitress there part-time. And she was just finishing up a bunch of schooling. And she was a part-time provincial parole officer. So she was a parole officer for the province. And then I met this girl. We started to hang out. And then she finished up all her stuff and she became a federal parole officer. Sorry guys, my dog's losing his mind right now. She became a federal parole officer and then that's it. She and I were together for 3 years and then we decided to get married. The marriage lasted 6 months. And then I'm like, I don't wanna do this anymore. She's like, are you serious? I'm like, yeah, I'm serious. I don't wanna do this anymore. So there was never any fighting, never anything bad. Things changed, you know, they weren't the same.
We're going to get more into this and more into more. Just, I love hearing about your story. We're going to take a quick break. I'm sure you want to let Cruz out, give him a little bit of attention. And we're going to be back for part two. We're hanging out here in the attic, talking with Chrome, the one and only Van City Van Life.
My name's Caden Johnson and I'm 10 years old. I really love working with tools in the garage with my dad, so I thought it would be a great idea to teach other kids about tools. And that's the idea where Growing Up Garage came from. Kids used to learn about tools in shop class. They got rid of those. In our workshop, we're going to teach you about tools that you can use in your everyday life, like a Phillips head screwdriver or a ratchet and socket. Don't forget the very useful wrench. This and so much more at your next Growing Up Garage workshop. What's great about Growing Up Garage is it's taught by kids like me. On behalf of Growing Up Garage, thank you for your consideration.
What's up, everybody? This is Jeremy, and this is Jeremy's World 10, and we are back in the attic with part two of this awesome conversation that we are hanging out with Chrome. Many of you have probably seen him on YouTube more than you've seen this crazy guy, unless you're in the market for suspension. You know, this guy just gives you everyday fun, which sometimes I would love to just be able to vlog and do that. However, having four kids, they pretty much, you know, are attached to me almost all the time, except when we are here. And now talking about kids, we had a 3-year relationship. We were talking about this with your ex-wife.
Yeah.
And then 6 months into it, boom, we're done. But out of that came your daughter.
No.
Oh, no. So we're not even...
No.
So spoiler alert, you know, like, see, now I'm even getting to learn here. Okay, so
yeah,
enlighten me, educate me.
So yeah, so I met that girl. She wasn't jealous at all. She didn't care. Okay. She let me do my club career. She was a great wife. But okay. I thought I was grown up enough for it. Turns out I wasn't grown up enough for it. We ended up dragging it out to last a year because she's like, please, can I say my first husband lasted 1 year? I'm like, okay. So we ended up just hanging out for the last 6 months of that. But yeah, no kids at all with her.
Okay.
And I'm a club DJ, so you can kind of take where the kids came from.
Okay. Gotcha. So now how, so like, so now let's go, because did your daughter ever live with you? Like, what was the...
No, just a girl from the club. You know what I mean? Okay. So
now she comes out. I mean, I saw where she came out and hung out with you, and yeah, you guys were doing stuff.
Yeah,
so.
Her and I hang out all the time. Less now that she's getting a little older, being busy and having a job and stuff like that. But I never met her until she was 6 years old. I had no idea. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, so you didn't even know that you had a daughter.
I knew about it when she was really young. And then, you know, I was young then too. So you know what I mean? Her mom didn't really. Yeah. So, I mean, it was kind of cool, the situation. I just kind of like, whatever. And I kind of, you know, like a bad dad, I kind of stayed away from it. And I wouldn't have known what to do. I was partying a lot during that time. And then when she was six, her mom ended up responding to something on my Facebook, and I made some comment about, you know, how awesome it is to be single. And her mom was like, I know a beautiful brown-haired, brown-eyed girl who loves music, loves to dance, that would change your mind. And I kind of went under her mom's profile. I'm like, oh my gosh. I'm like, are you saying, I've completely, like, she 100% me. I'm like, what? She's like, yeah, do you want to go to McDonald's and kind of see her? And then that was it. She was six, and me and my daughter have been hanging out. Usually try every other weekend since then. She's a cool kid.
Okay.
She's a cool kid.
So the first 6 years, you didn't know about it. Then all of a sudden, boom, here it goes. Yeah. And over a happy meal then, you learn that you have a daughter. You get to meet her for the first time.
Pretty much,
Then, so that is definitely crazy. You know, I mean, I guess, you know, that's the club life, I guess, right?
100% the club life. That's just a byproduct of being in the club scene, you know, from the ages of 19. I stopped DJing in the clubs when I was 40. You know what I mean?
Dang.
I spent my entire life in the clubs. That was my main job.
So was there, so I see in the early ages of your career where you were doing other things during the day, because the club thing, you know, I mean, that doesn't start till what, 8, 9 o'clock, goes till 2 in the morning, you know, like, is that kind of the setup? And then, you know, of course, we know now that it didn't stop at 2 in the morning. Like, it goes far beyond that till the sun comes up the next day.
Yeah.
So were you doing other entrepreneurial things during that time still during the day?
So, yeah. So during the day, that's when I got into doing things like just little things like selling reptiles and stuff like that, which wasn't a giant money maker. Or even when I was younger, like when I was 19, it was, you know, we're talking like I always did something during the day. So I, the other job I had while I was being a club DJ, entrepreneur wise, is I became a personal trainer. So I've lost a ton of weight. I was 26. I think it was 26. I lost a whole pile of weight. And then I just, during the day, I'm like, what do I do with my time during the day? So I took personal training courses, became a personal trainer. I did that for 6-7 years. And then,
so when we talk about a ton of weight, like, what are we talking?
I dropped a little over 50 pounds in 3 months and it was,
wow.
Yeah,
that's a lot.
Yeah. It was, I grinded hard and I just, you know, I just devoted everything to it. And then, yeah, after that, I've decided I wanted to take some of that time and go help other people. And then I became a little weight room instructor in a gym, like certified to like show people how to use machines. And then during that time, I took my personal training courses and became a certified personal trainer. And it was so easy. That was the easiest marketing I've ever done for myself in my life. At the gym, we put up my before and after photos. And people would walk in and be like, meet the new trainer. People would just walk in and be like, I want to buy sessions from him. He knows how I feel. Those fat pictures of mine sold so many personal training sessions.
I wish I had one right now that I could just like post it up on the screen and have some fun with. But now, what was it in your life that made you all of a sudden decide that you wanted to get healthy and you know, live a healthier lifestyle than, you know, previously?
Yeah, I prior to that, there was a stage in my club career I got into drugs really, really bad. I was using a lot of speed at the time, and believe it or not, you figured doing something like that would make you skinny. It didn't really. But I got into partying really hard there for 6 years, and I still DJing full time. The clubs loved me because I was full of energy, but it just started to break apart my friendships and stuff like that. And, you know, I started to get, you know, a little bit angry and stuff at the clubs. So I just decided one day out of nowhere after my girlfriend dumped me that I don't want to party anymore. So I took a pause from DJing for about 6 months, and then that's when I hit the gym and flipped my life completely upside down. You know what I mean? Stop hanging out, stop DJing in the town that I was in, away from all that. Because it was just one area that I was DJing in, and there was a lot of drugs at that club. So I just got sucked into it with everybody else. And then after that, I took 6 months of a break and then moved on and lost a ton of weight, flipped my life upside down, and then back to the club at it I went. But this time, a healthier, better version of me.
So during that time, do you feel like, did you have people like trying to do an intervention and be like, hey, you know, really, you shouldn't be doing this. You know, was there that, or it's like, they're all doing it, you're doing it.
Yeah.
It's just, you know.
Yeah. There was no real intervention. I had, one of my roommates at the time, Chris, he kicked me out. He was like, dude, I can't watch your spiraling, man. I can't watch this. You know what I mean? And I never seen it as spiraling because I was still DJing and, you know, all my regular work stuff was still on fire. Like, I wasn't damaging my club career at the time. So I looked at it myself as, I'm functioning, it's great. Then I had a girlfriend at the time that left and said, I can't watch this anymore. That's the one that shook me, because she was all I had. You know, being that, back to the same high school thing, I was always a bit of a solo person by myself. So, you know, even as my club career expanded, I knew a lot of people. A lot of people didn't know me, you know? So
that girl was kind of like the straw that, you know, broke the camel's back.
Yeah. Yeah.
And now, how long were you in a relationship with her?
She probably, I don't know, maybe 3 years.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So it was another like long term, but you decided, hey, we ain't doing this whole marriage thing again, because that was crazy the first time.
Yeah.
Didn't really work out so well. So at least you're learning from your mistakes as you, you know, get older and wiser. Well,
the marriage was later on in my life.
Okay, so then we got married again?
No, she would. No, my only wife was later on in my life.
So this is all previous to that.
That
okay.
was way earlier.
So we're getting this timeline a little bit mixed up.
Then. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So then once you met your wife, were you sober at that point?
I was drinking, you know, doing the usual casual drinking. But yeah, I was sober. So I stopped all that stuff when I was 26. So probably from 20 to 26 was just a huge party phase for me.
Okay.
Babies.
And now, just a little bit. Now, so the transition and going from like work, so then in that personal training, what do you think it was that didn't make you just continue to do that and like really pursue that even more?
So, like, as I mentioned earlier, like, I'm a person that likes to go all in on the one thing that I'm passionate for right now, go all in until I'm done going all in on it. Because, you know, like, someone recently told me this, and I love him saying that. He goes, just because you were a plumber and you were good at being a plumber doesn't mean you have to be a plumber for the rest of your life. Don't stick in something that doesn't make you happy all day, every day, right? So even when I was a kid, I was like, yeah, let's do sports cards. And when I was done with sports cards, I'm like, yeah, let's do a DJ service. When I'm done with that, I'm like, oh, now let's do this. You know, I've had one constant in my life through that whole time was the DJ part. It's my huge passion in my life. But the same thing happened as life goes on. You go passionate about one thing. Like, I'm like, I got all into the fitness. And then after a while, I'm like, I don't want to do this anymore. So time to move on.
How long did that fitness career last?
Six to 7 years, something like that. We'll say 6 years.
Okay. And then but we're still DJing. So then what did you do after that? What was the next step?
Still DJing. I just started to crank that DJ side of my life up a little bit. Like, things just got bigger. At that time, I was really getting into the club stuff. So we started doing a lot of clubs in different towns and different events and kind of like mini tours. So I tour like, you know, maybe, you know, 6 or 7 towns around my area, you know, like within like a 6 hour distance. We just go do a club 3 hours away at this one, then the next day 2 hours to the next club over there, and just bouncing around. We started to do that a lot. So the club career just started to crank up a little bit.
So now, being that I'm just curious on this, like, you never circled back and went back into weddings or doing anything you know, that sort of thing that you did in the earlier days?
I did for 1 year. So when I first moved into the van, when I very first moved into the van.
What year did you move into the van?
2017, I think it was.
Okay.
So yeah, I think 2017. Yeah, 2017. But yeah, when I first got into the van, like I was like, I had a day job there for the last while that I hated. And then when I quit my day job, I was like, okay, what am I gonna do for money now? You know what I mean? The clubs were only snagging a couple nights a week at the clubs. I'm like, well, how am I gonna get out of all this debt? So I had an opportunity to DJ at a private golf club to be their exclusive wedding guy and keep all my gear at the golf club, which meant I could go to a wedding and make $1,000 or $1,200 on a Saturday night. Well, that's more than my day job paid me in a week. So I did that for probably the first year, and I hated every minute of it. Going back and doing weddings for a club DJ is the worst in the world. But you know, I did it because it allowed me to focus on YouTube at the beginning. You know what I mean? I didn't have to have a job to get that money. I could do one day a week and make that $1,000.
So what was it that made you ultimately stop doing DJing? Because you said you did DJing up until you were 41.
Yeah, 40-something. Yeah, it was something like that. Like I still had a few small little club events when I first moved into my YouTube, when I first moved into my van. But I got into doing some mobile stuff at the end just because of the money. But honestly, my club career got pretty big. Like we did a lot of stuff at the tail end of my club career, and we started doing some tour stuff. So we're doing some bigger concerts for some bigger artists. This agent lady hired me to be the concert hype guy because I was so good with the crowd. She met me at a club once. This lady walked in and she was like, "Hey, you need to contact me." I'm like, yeah. I threw a card to the side. She comes in a month later. She's like, "You need to contact me." She's like, I need you. I'm like, yeah. I'm like, I judged her for what she looked like. You know what I mean? Because she didn't look like a whole lot. I'm like, yeah, well, what's this entertainment card? I don't care. I'm thinking, what is she, a DJ service? It says something, something agency on it. I'm like, whatever. And then she finally came in one day and she's like, "Look, you know, come into my office. Come see what we do." She's like, "I'll pay you for the day. If you need to be paid, I'll pay you to come down." And then, I started doing concerts for her, like big artist concerts. And what made me stop was I hit a little point in my club career where I felt like I couldn't go any farther. I was getting a little older. And like I'd do a club gig somewhere and some DJ would open for me. And the guy's like, "Dude, I feel so honored to be opening for you, man. Like you're such a legend in the industry." I'm like, legends are old. Then I just started to see the talent of the kids coming up now because they have so much technology at their fingertips that we didn't with the vinyl times. So like I can bust out a smooth mix, but these kids can do tricks like I can't. And I just kind of seen the time where I'm like, okay, it's better to go out now than go out, you know, fighting for gigs. You know, go out while I'm on top, go out while I still have a name. So yeah, I came off tour. We came off tour with Flow Rider. We did a little Flow Rider tour. It was cool. We were the opening act for him. So it was me and my buddy Bobby, which is a drummer. We did a ton of drum shows during my club career. So he just drummed along with me on a full drum kit while I just DJed to the club. Like he could jump in anywhere and just feel my vibe and we would just drum together. He wouldn't even have to know the track. The guy was so good. And then we had for the Flow Rider tour, we had an 11-foot LED robot. His name is Aborg. Look him up on Instagram, A-B-O-R-G. Okay. It is the coolest thing ever. But yeah, we toured with Aborg. And then I got off the Flow Rider show and I looked at my drummer. I said, "This is my last show. I would be cool if this was my final memory. I'm done." And that was it. I never took another gig after.
Yeah. Very, very impressive. I mean, it sounds like you definitely had fun. I mean, do you feel like, I know when I go do certain things, I'm like, man, half these kids that I'm that you're entertaining would be like, they could all be my kids. You know, I mean, at that age, you're like, hey, you know, you get the 20-year-olds in there and you're like, it's crazy. It just looks like, you know, kids.
Yeah.
I mean, literally.
Music was shifting a lot towards the end and you know, this starts to age me when you're like, I don't get this stuff. Like,
right. Like normally, I always say that. I'm like, I don't get it.
Yeah. Yeah. So like normally I'm like, I've been so influenced with music that if it's new and it's got a beat, let's go. Right. Cause for my whole club career, something new would come out. I may not understand the lyric part of it, but the beats were so good. And then I was DJing at a venue, which we ended up spinning a lot of hip hop stuff. And then hip hop changed so much and it was like mumble, mumble, mumble stuff. And people would come up to my DJ booth and I use my age as the factor to not play. They're like, "Hey, yo, you got any Drake?" I'm like, "Who's that?" they're like asking for amigos. I'm like, who dat? I don't know who that is. I'm old to be your dad. Just because I didn't like the vibe of the music. So that's round about the 2016 time. All that change.
Where it doesn't even make sense.
Yeah. So it was all that change around 2016 with all the music stuff. And then doing that last final tour, I was like, I can't hack the music nowadays. And like, it used to be, it's different now because now, like the whole club career, I knew my music first. I knew what was hot first, not the audience in front of me on the floor. Nowadays, because of social media and YouTube, stuff like that, the people on the dance floor are telling me what's new. And that started to get tough at the end.
Right. Like, definitely makes it more difficult. And I think I think it's neat on one aspect of it. You see so many people just, you know, getting noticed and getting found by putting up a TikTok video or something. You know, I mean, I was just looking at a country artist who did that. And it's like, I think they were saying he was the first artist to hit number one, like without being under a label. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's like, it's so, like, it goes back to that. We have more, you know, we have more things at our fingertips to be able to succeed than ever before. I mean, you think about, like, if you were selling baseball cards now, you could be posting them up, selling them to a guy in another country, essentially, versus just the people that are going to your market, you know, to that flea market. Yeah. It's pretty amazing. And I think that so many people take that for granted these days. It's like, there's unlimited possibilities. You can do anything. And if you don't know it, you don't even have to go to a library anymore to try to research it or learn it. Yeah. It's like, I can instantly know all of this random crazy stuff. We could talk about, you know, Fraser Valley reptiles, you know, I mean, otherwise how would we know this stuff?
Yeah.
You know, and I think that is pretty awesome and definitely want to, you know, encourage people to do things. I mean, I think that's a lot of, you know, we have the nonprofit called Growing Up Garage.
Yeah, which is cool.
We're really trying to teach kids just basics of using tools, because whether you want to be a mechanic or not, it's still just being able to learn the fundamentals of tools. Like, you never know when you're going to need to know how to use a screwdriver or whatever it may be. Yeah. I mean, there's so many adults nowadays that are like, I don't even know how to do that.
Yeah, right.
You know, so it's one of those things. So thankfully you have YouTube. You can be like, how do you change an oil filter on this? Or how do I fix my whatever is instantly at your fingertips?
Yeah.
But I think it's still great to have that hands-on knowledge and work as a team and do things like that. We definitely have a lot of fun doing that with Growing Up Garage. So 2016, we are done DJing. We're done with our 9-to-5 job. Like, no more 9-to-5. What was going on in your life that you were like, I don't want to work? You were over it? Like, where, like, bring me to where you were at in 16.
I had a day job in 2016. So,
doing.
I worked for a chemical company. We did water treatment for steam boilers. So I drove around in a Ford Econo line van full of pails of chemical, and I just tested water at hospitals and food plants and whatever else. And I did that for 5 years on that stint. And I got done with it. I had a boss I didn't like. And you know what I mean? Like, me and it was just a small company, father, son, and me. And me and the son were ambitious as heck. And just we couldn't expand ourselves there. So we kept hitting that brick wall of the owner that wasn't open-minded to younger ideas around him. And then, I just kind of felt crushed there every day. And then it was around that time when, shortly after 2016, that I quit my day job. And then this is nuts. I literally quit the job, came home. I'm like, what the heck am I going to do? I have like 25 grand in debt. I have no means of making money except for DJing. I'm like, this is going to be a long haul. So how am I going to get rid of all this debt? I'm like, well, let's cut out my biggest bill. And most people look at their bills as like, okay, let's knock out the biggest bill. I'm like, no. Let's knock out the biggest bill I have. And that's not my debt.
On a month-to-month basis.
That's my rent. So it was during that time. And I bought a van for, so at the time I, at a company I DJed for a lot, and they wanted to know if I wanted to get into doing school dances. And I already owned a full big school dance setup with the screens and stuff. It had just been sitting there forever. So I'm like, okay, cool. So I bought a van to do school dances for these guys. You know what I mean? Because they were during the week. I was still DJ Thursday, Friday nights, and the school dances sometimes be on a Monday or a Tuesday. And so, yeah, I started doing school dances, and I bought this van. And I bought the van on August 16th. I bought it on my birthday. And then I bought the van in August, thinking I was going to use it to do DJ gigs. And I quit my job at the time. And it turns out August 16th, and by September 11th was my first day living in my van full time. I just decided, screw it. Bye-bye bills. I dropped my lease at the place I was at, and moved into my van within a month of buying it.
And now this is this van right here.
This one right here. This is why. Okay. This is why this van has gone through so much repairs, and I don't give a crap how much this thing rusts. I will pull it apart. I will chop it out. I'll weld in more because this. I owe my world to this van.
So, what made you at that point in your life go, "Hey, I'm gonna go live in my van"? Because I'm assuming it was not built out. It was an empty cargo van.
It was, yeah.
So what made you go, "I'm going to go live in my van," versus like, "I'm going to go"? With most people's rationale would be like, "I'm going to go move in with a buddy. I'm going to go rent a room. I'm going to go do that." Like, what was the thought process behind that that made you just go, "No, I'm going to go live in my van down by the river"? You know, like, what was it?
So yeah, I bought the van, and me and the dog, I had my other bulldog Disco at the time. Me and the dog went out for a couple of days, just threw a little bed in the back. We went out and did a couple day camping trip, and I'm like, man, you could live in this thing. Like, man, I could chuck my DJ gear in here and I could just live in this. And then that thought brought me back to my apartment. I'm sitting, I had a really nice studio desk with my turntables and vinyl there. Beautiful. And I'm sitting on the computer and I look up living in a van. I'm like, holy crap, you could do that? And then that was it. I literally turned.
So you said you looked up. Where did you go to look this up?
I just went on, like, I went on to YouTube. Yeah, I just went on YouTube and I typed in living in a van. And I didn't dive deep into it. I watched a couple of videos. I'm like, okay, cool. People can do this. I literally, from that point on, literally, and no kidding, grabbed my phone, turned around, snapped pictures of everything in my condo. Within 4 days, it was empty.
I got just for sale, everything. All of yard
it.
Sale.
All of it. Just, okay. I sold everything. I sold a bunch of my DJ gear to a DJ friend of mine, which is kind of cool because the actual turntables I used to tour with, they've been all over the place. I sold them to him, and I bumped into him the other day, and he told me that he'd be willing to sell them back to me. And I'd love, now that I've got the shop space, I'd love to have the turntable. And he's like, dude, your cases have been, they're all the outside cases, the travel cases are all banged up from years of being on the road. And I'm like, I have to have those back, bro. So
that is rad. Now, do you still have an amazing vinyl collection?
No, because as soon as I left my condo, I sold sold everything.
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 Everything must go. Okay.
Yeah.
So definitely a huge, I'm going to call it leap of faith, going like, hey, I'm going to go do this. And so how long was it then once you moved into this van that you were like, hey, this isn't bad. Like, I kind of like this. I mean, was it like instant, or did you kind of get into it and be like, what in the hell was I thinking that I could go live in my van?
Yeah, it was instant love right out the gate. I freaking loved it. I did. So when I built my van out, I kept that back section here, like where my fridge and stuff is. I kept that open for DJ gear. So I put my DJ controller, because I was still DJing at a couple of small little clubs at the time. And then I had some speakers and stuff back there for booth monitors and stuff. So I kept my stuff with me. But it was instant love right out the very gate. I absolutely loved it. I put all my actual DJ gear in a storage locker, but it was only in the storage locker for 6 months. Like, I had all my school dance set up in the storage locker, everything. And then after 6 months, I sold all of it. And that was just me, and everything I owned was inside of here.
So we're going back to all in then.
Yeah.
In living in a van and saying, hey, I'm done with normal, or what would be classified by society as normal, without even really, I'm going to say, doing like a ton of research into being like, hey, you just, it sounds like you almost just went and did it to be like, am I crazy? Am I not crazy? Or like, you know, is this even a doable thing? I mean, we know that people have been living in their cars forever and traveling and doing that. But like, definitely when I go back to 2016, it's like, I think about even like how many vans that we did in 2016, which wasn't, you know, a lot. Like people were getting into it. Like I would probably go back 2012, like more and more, but 2000, it wasn't still like cool, let's say, you know, it wasn't, there was no hashtag van life in 2016. So I definitely want to hear more about this. We're going to keep going. We're going to talk about what it's like to live in a van now that you are doing it, what the future holds for you in your van and beyond the van, because I'm doing my math really, you know, in the top of my head. And I think we're 7 years in the van life. Could it change or maybe not? We're going to find out. We're coming back for part three.
And I ended up deciding to just go for it and get the 5-inch Baja Grocery Getter kit with the Fox shocks and the progressive leaf springs in the rear.
I cannot explain how much better the van is now. It drives like an entirely new vehicle.
And there you have it. This is the completed Weltech Designs Baja Grocery Getter 5-inch lift kit. Here's a little before and after. Yeah, and that is a cool transformation.
All right, today's the day when we're taking the Weltech Designs Baja Grocery Getter kit out of the garage and on the van.
Like an injured bird needing a nest, a place to rest.
All in all, I am very pleased with the lift. It is super crazy. It's super fun. We've taken it out on multiple camping trips already. Everywhere I go, people stop me and go, what in the heck is up with this thing? I'm driving down the road and you'll see dudes like rubbernecking trying to check it out. It's crazy. I park it at work and people are just blown away with it.
Are you kidding me? In that van on an ATV trail? So let me tell you, it was so good to put those KO2 tires that are on my van and that Weltech lift kit to the test. First time ever I've had it out here and done something like that. Treated this thing like a go-kart with a Weltech Designs Baja Grocery Getter lift kit.
All right, what's up everybody? We are back. This is Jeremy and this is Jeremy's World 10. We are hanging out with the one and only Chrome Valdez and having a good time talking about life. More importantly, his life and just how awesome it has been. And you never know that where the road is going to lead you. However, literally the road has led him to so many places in a van and it's pretty amazing. And you get to see this. I mean, you're putting out how many videos per week now, usually?
Five on average.
Which is insane.
Oh, insane. And I always try for seven, but, you know, five, sometimes
four. That's
like
four. Casey Neistat status right there.
Yeah, it's insanity. Absolute insanity.
So do you get to actually enjoy then the places that you go?
Because
you're like,
no,
you're at, it's like film, edit.
Yeah.
You know,
so I woke up in this beautiful oceanside spot today. I edited from 4 o'clock to right around 9 o'clock. And then I uploaded. While I was uploading, I made breakfast. Then usually that's when I turn my camera on and then open my, and then go start my day. But everything's on camera. So
you, and then these damn guys from Weltech Design said, hey, let's hang out and bullshit. And I want to talk about, you know, your life and everything. So now we're going to jump into this van life. We're living in a van life. We're still DJing, but now you completely said, all right, sold everything and went all in van life and then started building out your van. So walk me through that story, just like where you got inspiration from, why you did with what you did with your van. And then I want to get into like, if you were to go back and change anything, like what would it be for those people that are like, hey, when I build out my van, I want to do this. And you're like, hey, wait a second, you should probably do this.
Yeah. So, I mean, like moving into the van was just, it was a good vibe from the very beginning. So from the time, and I have every video on my channel from driving away from my old apartment. I have the last day I filmed it all. So moving into the van, even the first couple of nights was the funnest thing I ever did. It was just, it kind of felt kind of like you're
on vacation.
Yeah. It was just, it was just fun. Like, and I slept right downtown Vancouver, right by the great big arena that's in town. So it was busy down there. I put myself somewhere where I was comfortable and it was just good and fun the entire time.
Like, and the whole transition into it, I mean, selling everything is, you know, you learn after you sell half of it that, hey man, this was fun. It's really liberating once you start ditching everything that you have. It was a lot of fun. It's hard to say that now because I've accumulated so much.
So now, what's your goal? You mentioned this early on that you were, you know, deep into debt. So was your goal then like, hey, I'm going to reduce my expenses as much as possible, and my goal is to get out of debt? Was that where your kind of mindset was?
Yeah. So I had about 25 grand in debt at the time. And sorry, guys. I'm dying here.
Water.
Yeah. Coffee.
Oh, even better. I could go for one of those.
My water's got a problem right now. It's empty.
Oh, man.
That's okay. My coffee's cold. So what was that question again?
So, man, now you got me all sidetracked. See, I'm like a squirrel. No, so I was saying, like, what was the big things? Like, so you wanted to get out of debt. That was your main thing, your objective 100%. At this time. Like, hey, I just don't want to owe anybody money.
100%.
And moving into the van allowed you to do that?
Yeah, because, I mean, like, you could still earn all the money that you were already earning before, but that $1,300 that went to rent never had to go to rent anymore. That means I had $1,300 a month if I continued everything that I was doing that could go to my bills. And I knocked out that money in 9 months. Debt gone. And if I were to go back and look at it, getting out of debt, working a regular day job, having my regular home expenses and commuting expenses and stuff, there's no way I'd be out of debt in 10, 15 years. It would be not possible, you know, because home comes with a lot of other expenses too. And, you know, little things, you get caught up with home stuff and spending and dumb, silly things and buying stuff because your work job makes you unhappy, but buying that cool part for your car makes you excited. You know, you
do. I have no idea what you're talking about when it comes to that. Yeah. You know, I don't like buying car parts at all. Yep. Not really a car guy. So, you know, I just... Well, I can't relate to that one right there.
So yeah, and it just knocked debt out quick, and that, like, that to be debt free in 9 months or 10 months, something like that, was wicked.
And now during this whole time, did you start filming videos for your YouTube channel with the intention of making, hey, I'm gonna make content for YouTube?
No.
Or was it strictly just living in your van,
no,
getting out of debt?
So the funniest story is, because I have such an elaborate club career behind me, you know, with doing so many different concerts from like Ice Cube to top 40 guy like Flo Rida. Like, we did so much stuff. So between all that and all the nightclub stuff that I was doing and all the connections I had in the nightclub world, I wanted to start a YouTube channel for DJing because I had so much to offer, so much to, because I was watching the DJ channels at the time, and those DJ channels were like, they'd talk, but not show you anything. Like, I wanted to talk and go into the clubs and introduce them to the club managers, talk to the club managers of what they wanted of new DJs, and then maybe show spinning at that club that night, like real DJ stuff. And then I'm like, okay, well, because my DJ career was so polished, I wanted to make sure that my first video was polished, like it was good enough to throw up there to fit what DJ Chrome was. And so I'm like, okay, I'm moving into the van, let's just film it. So I started to film moving into my van, not for the purpose of starting a van life YouTube channel. I filmed going into a van because I needed the pressure on me to edit. You know what I mean? So I'm like, all right, I'm gonna film everything. So I started to edit living in my van, and before you know it, I had a video that took off and I made $100. I'm like, if I can make 100, I can make 1,000. And that was the mindset. And before you know it, I wasn't DJing at all. And I was like, screw this, I'm just a van life YouTube guy now.
And now, how long did it take you from, you know, going from that point A to point B where you said, okay, I'm just going to do van life YouTube?
Probably 6 months. Like, it was about 3 or 4 months in, and I had a couple of videos grab a little bit, but it was probably 6 months in where I realized, okay, this could be something. So it was at that time that I stopped DJing at the, I was still doing, like I said at the beginning, I got into doing gigs at a private golf club because the pay was well. It was around 6 months into van life, that I stopped doing things at the golf club. I'm like, that's it. You know, because I've been the guy, I'm sure you've noticed in this conversation that I've done so many different little things. Like, when I have a passion
for... None whatsoever related to each other.
Zero.
You know, other than the DJing, that's the only common denominator
in it.
That's like,
right.
Everything else is like polar opposites.
That's right. So like, but like everything else, like with the YouTube thing, once it started to grab, I was enjoying the editing part. And once that started to grab a little bit, I knew if I didn't give it 100%, I'd never get 100% out of it. I did that with everything else. So that's it. I said bye-bye to doing gigs at the golf club and gave YouTube 100%. And I'm going to, you have to do that. You give something 60%, you're only going to get 60% out of it. So I devoted everything to YouTube and off it went. And no regrets, man. It's been awesome.
And I think that that's how so many side hustles, you know, sort of start. It's like, hey, I'm going to do this. But I think do you felt like by just going all in, it was kind of like, I'm either going to fall on my face and fail or I'm going to succeed? Or was that...
Well, I've been like that my whole life with stuff. I think just because I started playing around with things when I was younger. I mean, sure, I was playing around with my uncle's money doing the sports card thing. But, you know, like if you failed, it's okay. You could just go back and do something else. Like I was born and raised poor. Like my mom was on welfare. We had no money at all growing up, like zero. So being broke, whatever. I'm an expert at that. You know, I've watched that my whole life. There's no wealth in our family anywhere. Our family is just known for being broke. It's been all my aunts and uncles were the same way growing up. Everybody was on welfare and living in low income housing and stuff. So I was raised around it. So, you know, I always found that
nothing to lose.
So anytime I've went into something all in to pull all back out of it and try something new was no big deal. Like I always found that I got excited for something for a little while. And then after a while, the excitement starts to diminish. Now it's time for change. So the same thing now, you'll notice like even with like, you know, like YouTube, I've shifted my passion for something. I got into YouTube. I'm hitting year number 7 and now it's time for that shift and change again. I feel it in here. You know what I mean? Right?
Yeah. So before we get into that though, I have to go back to 2020 and when COVID happens, like how did COVID affect your life and living in a van?
It's so horrible to say because so many people had rough times during that time. That was the greatest thing that has ever happened to anybody that was making YouTube videos at the time. Our channels blew up, all of them. If you were making steady content, you had a base audience, you were moving somewhere.
Yeah, nobody had anything to do but, I mean, watch videos. I mean, I know for us, like, I mean, it was like crazy numbers. All of a sudden, people were just at home watching stuff. So it was like, yeah. And then... I think for us, it then put fuel to the fire, and it wasn't even like normal fuel. It was like highest octane jet fuel on it. And even for us at Weld Tech Designs, you know, just everybody was like, hey, if I can't go on vacation, I'm going to build a van, a motor, I'm going to build something. I'm going to go do stuff. And I think it was like shortly after that, then where you and I really had the first opportunity to meet.
Yep.
I reached out to you and said, hey, have you ever heard of us?
Oh, yeah.
You
know? Come on now.
And, you know, but that's, you know, I think that's like the humbleness in me. Like I always just am still like, hey, we build van suspension. You know, have you ever seen it? And you were like, well, heck yeah, I have. You know, and I was like, well, dude, I would love to put it on your van. I think it would totally completely change it. And so for so many years, you went with just normal suspension, trying all of these upgrades on your van, adding Adelies, adding these things that, people tell you on the internet are amazing and work really good. So walk me through that. Like as you started doing your build out, did it get heavier? You needed more suspension? What was going on there?
Like at the beginning, it was okay. I mean, as you added stuff to it, it's not a big deal. You know, added weight. I didn't really know. The van was okay. We didn't add a leaf in the back just because I broke a leaf spring anyway. So we did that anyway. It brought the back up a tiny little bit. But what changed it all for me was changing from being a street van life guy who lived on the side of a road all the time in the city was me going to like more dirt places. And that's where my excitement for van life got better, because the first couple of years I was just in the city. It's all it was just people and filming graffiti stuff and everything city. Then I started to play around in some local close backcountry stuff and I got hooked. Then that's when you start realizing the suspension is horrible and that clearance is king out there. Not the 4x4 kit, clearance is king. And it just changed everything. At the time, I'm like, okay, I need a suspension lift. You know what I mean? Like, and that's when I came up with you guys online. I'm looking around, and if anybody owns a Ford Econoline and enjoys some time in the dirt, they know who Welltech Designs are. Why? Because not everybody can afford a $25,000 4x4 kit. I know I didn't at the time, but right. You guys are in the wheelhouse that would get you all that adventure for a fraction of the cost. You know, and I think back then, I think your kits were, you know, around $4,000. Oh, it was a bit more because we had to ship it here at the time. What, like?
I think we were like $2,400, you know, for the normal kit. And then if you wanted to add the leaf springs, it was like another, you know, $1,200.
Yeah.
You know, like at the beginning of COVID. And then just we saw that, you know, everybody, you couldn't get anything and everybody was increasing their prices. I mean, it was still a lot of money, especially when you look at like, hey, the cost of my van is let's even say I paid $5,000 for my van to put a suspension on it that's $4,000. Like, how do you justify that? You know, it's definitely one of those things that are hard to justify for, I think, a lot of people that don't understand, like, maybe the components that go into it or what they're really trying to achieve. I think that that's a big part of it as well.
Yeah, but I mean, I wish we could just convey the little, like, that little bit of money that goes into your van gives you 10 times the adventure than you would ever expect. Like, my van life changed once that lift kit hit. I'm not saying that because it's your face in front of me. Once I got that suspension lift, there was no stopping me after that. Like, because, like, honestly, out here, clearance is king. Like, I've been in places with my van and ran into some guys in some Toyota trucks, and we were just chatting. The guy's like, it's cool to see a 4x4 van out here. I'm like, I'm a two-wheel drive. And I get excitement out of saying it's a two-wheel drive because, like, you got out here with that? I'm like, yeah, I have a rear locker in the rear end, but still, suspension is everything. Getting that lift and that clearance gets you into some gnarly places that, you know, normal, like a regular pickup truck can't get into. Like, that height is absolutely everything.
Now, do you feel like another benefit in it for yourself is, I mean, I'm looking at your cabinets. You have a lot of wood cabinets. You have a lot of things. You have your, you know, you showed me your mixer booth. But do you feel like, you know, by having that suspension in there as well, and I don't want to make this like too, like, but like where you felt the difference even in there where it's not beating up you, you know, and all of the components in your van?
Yeah, actually, honestly, like this thing, when I first put it in, you know, it's the first time I've ever had any lifted suspension at all. I figured it was going to be like handle a little bit weird, be a little bit rough, but it soaks in everything. Like, even out here in the backcountry, drop that air down and sometimes you can whip over those bumps like they're no tomorrow. Right.
Hey, you know, when in doubt, just skiddy pedal, you know, throttle out. I mean, I joke around, but it's kind of like the faster you go, you know, the better it is on some of those roads, of course.
100%.
You know, always be careful and drive with caution. But yeah, I mean, it's just so much fun. I mean, I've even blown away so many customers, you know, taking them on rides and, you know, having fun with them. So it's definitely always fun to see like what other people are doing with our vans and now our motorhomes, like where they're going with these things is, you know, pretty darn awesome. Definitely impressed. So we blow up the motor, 4.6 liter, done. Like, okay, what? And now, so I have to tell you that because now I understand that this was the OG van from like day one, why you can't get rid of it, you know? So I think that has been awesome. So I see now, like, I am answering my own question because it's like, well, duh, I'm just going to put a bigger motor in it and make it everything I want it to be.
Yeah, and I think if this van didn't have that nostalgia, that, because, like, I literally have everything in my life because of this van I paid $6,500 for on a super high interest loan at the beginning. And, you know, I didn't have any money at the time, so I did. I got this on a high interest loan, and I paid that loan off when I paid my debt off. This van owed me nothing, but it gave me everything. You know
absolute
what I mean?
Freedom.
So absolute freedom. So this thing should have been tossed a long time ago when I found that my front floor rotted right through. I was jumping in the van and you hear this crack and I'm like, what the heck? Pull the rubber mat off. You could see my tire. The whole front floors were rotted right out on it. And then, you know, that's when I would have said, I don't know what to do, and got rid of it then, but I fixed it. And then I realized all the rust underneath it. That's okay, I fixed it. And if it comes back again, I'll fix it again. Why? Because why get rid of something that's, look where I am right now.
I think because we're in a throwaway society.
Yeah.
Nowadays, it's like, hey, it's broken, throw it away, get another one. Instead of being like, hey, let's take the time to fix this and make it just amazing and like almost put your signature on it where it's like, this is rad and I love it, you know? And everything that you look back on, go, hey, I worked hard to fix this and make it better. Mm-hmm. And it's a part of me, like even more so, where it's just like ingrained in you, where it's like, I still have my OG van from, it's a 1997 Ford Econoline with 200,000 plus miles on it. I bought it in 01. Same thing, high interest, but I was like, I needed to have this thing for racing, and I just can't get rid of it. Still in my parking lot. We did some rooted videos. I want to do more rooted videos where we have fun doing crazy stuff with it.
Yeah.
You know, but that's it. So I get it. So now we have the big engine in the, so do you love it? Is it amazing?
I do love it. I mean, like, yeah, I love it. It's like going from that, the 4.6 is a little small. Like, you know what I mean? Like that's one piece of advice that I wish I knew at the beginning is, you know, but I didn't think I'd ever be a backcountry boy. That 4.6 is awesome on the pavement, but when you need something out of it, it doesn't have anything to give you. Right.
So especially you start putting larger tires on it. You start doing all this other stuff.
That's right. So like, I mean, I didn't think I was never a backcountry boy when I started my van life. I was a city boy. I go camping, forget that. There's dirt out there. I ain't going. That was my thought. I'm like, my whole life have been like that. I wasn't a camping guy. Now, well, life's changed a lot. It's probably it's probably thanks to you and your damn lift kit that I love being out here so much, you know?
My wife, now you sound like my wife, Chrome. You know, like it's always my fault, you know? But hey, I see this constant smile and happiness, though, that I love bringing to people. You know, like I really do love the freedom that it gives, because, you know, I don't get to go and experience all of this stuff. I get to live vicariously through other people, you know, through amazing pictures. I have a lot of fun. I mean, my true passion is I really have fun designing stuff and, you know, coming up and solving problems and making stuff better, and being able to give people, you know, the opportunity to do this. So now we have some killer bumpers on, you know, your van, which are of course awesome, but really what I think is even more like amazing is what your next adventure is. So tell me, like, what craziness are you got going on?
So this applies to my story as the story moves on. I do something hard for a while and then I lose passion for it and I shift onto something new and I shift onto something new and I keep doing that and until, you know, I get bored and I try something new. My life's been like that forever. So van life for me has been awesome and fun. I will never ever, I need a place to live. I will live in my van forever. So, but what's happening now is that my passion is changing and shifting a bit. I need more excitement in my life, because once you start doing the same thing for too long, you got to do something else cool to make things awesome. So that's where this new shift for me came in, is I needed some other way to spark some excitement in my life. So we decided that we're going to build a shop in Coombs, BC, and start an online store and a shop doing, or we're not quite sure what the shop's going to entail quite yet. We're still kind of working on that part. But yeah, starting an online store where people can purchase the products that I have on my van. And this whole adventure started because everybody around me, my whole time on my channel, has been making a fortune and I've made nothing, you know? So I figured, okay, well, let's start selling the products that I have on my van instead of people going, well, do you have a link for that? And I send them the link and they go there and buy it. And I get, they just get tons of free marketing on my channel for years. And then I get nothing from it. You know what I mean?
Got it.
So yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, that entrepreneurial spirit now kind of continues. Now, what do you think it is that just continues to fuel these new projects? I mean, is it just something in you that, I mean, do you feel like you're that young kid with something to prove as far as, like, you know, being successful? Like what, like proving that whoever, you know, Billy on the playground, like, hey, you know what? Like, You didn't do anything, and I've accomplished all of these different careers not related to each other, like subconsciously. Like, what's what do you think fuels it?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I've always had this hyperactive creative mind, and maybe it's like maybe it's an ADD thing, but I got a passion
for speed that never wore off.
Yeah, maybe I got a passion for something, and then it just diminishes and it stops making me excited every day. And then I just like, I got to change. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think it's like wanting to prove something to those guys back then, because then you'd focus on one thing and build an empire around it. Okay. All I cared about is like, as long as that adventure inside of me was just constant fireworks inside of excitement, then I'm into it. So that's where this new thing comes in. And where do I get these ideas? If you sat in my shop with me, man, my brain never quits. Like, never. Like, even Lauren around me, Lauren's like, where do you come up with this stuff? I'm like, I just have these ideas, and they never, ever, ever stop.
I can totally relate. And I feel like it's a blessing and a curse.
Yeah, big time.
Because, you know, I'm always, you know, like even myself, I mean, I've had a clothing company and a limo business and all of these things. Nice. Meanwhile, doing a fab shop, I mean, like I've had so many different businesses.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, like still like, so I can see that. I'm like, I've always been a welder fabricator, but I'm like, hey, I want to do this marketing company, and we're going to do this and make shirts and do this. Okay. I'm going to go buy all this equipment and do it. And I'm like, okay, cool. And then we opened up a machine shop. I'm like, okay, I want to do all, you know, so I totally can relate to that. And my wife is like, seriously, can you just sleep? And I'm like, I hate sleeping. I really do. I'm like, there's so much that I want to try to accomplish, and I see something and I'm like, oh my gosh, like this would be awesome. And I become passionate about it and start being like, okay, I could totally do this. And I'm thankful that I don't have that mindset of being like, oh no, I probably can't do that, or I would fail. Like, I feel like we could relate to each other, and we would be complete trouble around each other on a daily basis. Cause I'd be like, hey Chrome, what do you think of this? And you'd be like, yeah, that's a good idea. Let's do it. And, you know, tomorrow we're, you know, who knows what we're doing.
Yeah,
and we're
who like, knows?
Yeah, I mean, and then my wife's like, seriously, you guys need to stop. I'm like,
no,
I know, but we're having fun, you know. I'm like that kid that never wants to grow up. And I think, you know, I think I have part of why I have so much fun, you know, racing go-karts and doing all this fun stuff with my kids as well. I get to, you know, vicariously live through them and just have a good time, because I am that, you know, adult that refuses to grow up. I just want to have fun. I want to enjoy life. I want to, you know, get the most out of it, which, you know, sounds like you're doing with no regrets, enjoying like every, you know, step along the road.
Yeah.
And it sounds like this path is, you know, like I look at it like a big map, has led you down so many roads that even when it may seem like a dead end, it's just a dirt road that you get to experience differently.
Yeah, 100%. So yeah, this whole new adventure I'm going, I just want to give people what I got. You know what I mean? Like I want to see, kind of like your scenario there, I want to see people leave my shop or leave my store with the products or whatever they're getting from us, and just have all the same experiences that I've had with them. Because anytime you add something new, whether it be a window on the side of my van, like that thing changes the game every day. And I want to give that opportunity to somebody. And in the larger shop space of mine, I would love to be out here installing Weltech design kits, sending people out, being super happy, you know, installing, you know, bumpers and, you know, off-road lighting and stuff like that. They go out, hit the trail, changes the game for them. I want them to feel the same excitement that I do. So that's my excitement for the new shop, is kind of just taking all this new creativity, funneling it into something else, because YouTube's great. I love YouTube. It's fun. But my creativity starts to feel like it's starting to kind of get
plateau.
Yeah. Like it's, you know, it's the same all the time. Like it's the same video, same edit, same kind of day, still making breakfast, still, hey guys, good morning. Hey, look, it's the tree. You know what I mean? Like I enjoyed the adventure of it, but I feel creatively I need to push hard on something else, something bigger. And
well, I think what's amazing about that is that now that you've, it's not like you jumped into this 6 months ago and you're like, hey guys, buy all this stuff. It's literally what has been a part of your life for the last 6-7 years.
That's right.
And you could tell somebody like, hey, I wouldn't start building your van on that 4.6 liter. Or if you're going to do this, hey, I would think about this. Or, you know, I've used X amount of these heaters and this is the one that works the best.
Yeah.
You know, all of these things that are going to play a part, which you're going to save people a ton of headaches, because we all kind of like wander down these roads and we're like, ah, what should I do? What should I do?
That's right.
Where if you have a great tour guide like yourself and a store that you can trust, I feel like, okay, I could go to you and I know that you're not just recommending this to
That's
me
right.
because it has a high margin. You're like, hey, I use this in my van.
Yeah.
Every single one of my lift kits, like I have that van. I own that van. Here it is. You want to go drive it? Let's go have some fun.
That's
like,
right.
And if it's not what you thought, like I'm okay with you not buying it. And I'm just cool with being your friend.
Yeah.
Like totally okay with that, you know? So I think that that is amazing. And I love that so much and can't wait to get behind you and that. And I think it's just, you know, I'm super excited for it.
Yeah,
I look
too.
Forward to seeing, you know, all that you do because you've already done so much. This is, you know, what better thing to do than when you hit 50 is to, you know, open up your own store.
Right.
Like, to me, like that is awesome. You know, like, I mean,
I've been dreaming about this for a long time. There's been the last couple of years of my channel where I've kind of felt, okay, I need something new. What am I going to do? What am I going to do that's bigger than what I'm doing now? I need, because I've always been like that. I'm like, okay, I get comfortable here, time to go here. Get comfortable here, time to go here. Now I'm here. I'm like, now let's go here. Well, how am I going to get here? What do I have to do? You
right.
make another big YouTube video, do another big adventure. I'm like, let's open up a store, something that I can build on for like the last 10 years. Cause you know, I'd like to not work when I'm 70, you know what I mean? So I'd like,
yeah. And even if you can manage it, or maybe you come to that point where someone's like, hey, I really like this. I want to buy it.
Beautiful.
You know, perfect. Okay. You get to walk away from it and, you know, truly just enjoy life. I definitely want to thank you so much for taking the time to come out and hang out with me. I mean, I got to learn so much more about you that I did not know.
I'm pretty sure everybody learned a lot about me today.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that is awesome, especially because you're such a public person. And I love the fact that you, even when we brought up the whole Fraser Farms, like you thought it was hilarious and just was like, oh my God, I can't believe this. You know,
that's hilarious.
So I think that that was great. And then to come to find out that you've never done a podcast with anybody else, I'm truly thankful. And, you know, thank you for taking the time to hang out with
me.
No
worries.
I really do appreciate that. And I do value our friendship. I do love talking to you all the time and think it's, you know, it's a good time. I look forward to the day that, you know, we get to finally meet up and go do some off-road and have some fun together.
Yeah.
But, yeah, just... Again, want to say thank you guys. You guys already know this is Chrome. I will definitely put links to Van City Van Life all down below. And also, you never mentioned the name of the new shop.
The name of the new shop is vantoys.com. I called it Van Toys because, man, where do you want to go to get toys for your van? Van Toys. It just made sense.
At least it's not some crazy long name like the DJ name, you know? So that we would never be able to remember and then be like, hey, what was that name again?
Van Toys. Easy.
Yeah. So that's awesome because, perfect toys. Go play in your sandbox. You'll be able to hit up Chrome. And we look forward to him carrying our products up
you
in
betcha.
Canada. That is going to be awesome as well for anybody watching in Canada. So I'm excited about that.
Yeah, me
that.
Too. Me too.
But thanks guys so much for watching. I'm Jeremy. This is my world. And I'm so thankful to have Chrome be a part of my world today. I'll see you guys in the next video.